studies on financial stewardship, we are still looking at the right relationship between a believer and money. The next Sunday, we'll start looking at giving as worship. Maybe it will take 2 Sundays, then from there we go and look at tithe and the church. And then we will have come almost to the end. Maybe we'll look at lastly the sustenance of the church programs. So we go back to 1 Timothy chapter 6. We'll read again from verse 6 through verse 11. Now godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with this we shall be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptations and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men into destruction and perdition. Verse 10. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Verse 11. But you, O man of God, flee these things and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and gentleness.
Amen.
In this study, this is one of the most difficult places for me to teach. Because to balance between understanding that money is good, there's nothing wrong with money. Actually, money is immoral. Money is not immoral. Money is not good. Money is neutral. Money is immoral. It has nothing bad and it has nothing good about it. So let's start by saying that money does not make decisions. Money can never make decisions. Money is a dead thing. Money has no life in itself. The power of money comes from the soul that is holding that money. The power of money depends on who has the money in his hands. Money can never choose to do evil. And money can never choose to do good. It's me and you who have this money that choose how we will use it. It's me and you who have this money that choose how we will use the money. And therefore, we can never blame money. We cannot say that this man now has so much money, he's rich and that. It is him, it is not the money. Actually, you can be rich and be the most peaceful man, be the most gracious person, be the most amazingly kind person, be the best worshiper and a rich person. But you can be rich and be very miserable. Because money can never choose how you live. Money can only bring out more of who you really are. Hope you hear that. Money can only reveal the real you. Either when you have it or when you don't have it, money exposes your spiritual position. Money exposes your love for God. Money exposes your love for self. So money can only bring out more of you. Just as some people will not come to congregate together because they don't have money, others will not come because they have money. So, if you allow money to rule your life, then there will be always a reason why you cannot come to congregate together with others. Either you have much more money and there are things you need to do, or you have no money and you feel inadequate to be among other brethren. But we need today to reach at a level where we agree that money can never control us. We have power and authority over money because it is our money. We are the ones who own it in trust of God. We are the stewards of this money. It is in our pocket. I remember Peter telling Ananias and his wife that while you sold the land, the money was within your hands. Why did you choose to come before God and now lie to him? You had the ability to stay with the money away without having to come and say, this is how much we sold the land. Because nobody was forcing you to do that. So, as we undertake this study, we are coming from a point of understanding or a philosophy that money is a neutral agent. If money has no morality, money has no goodness, money has no evil. If you like good language, money is amoral. We looked at contentment last Sunday. We spent most of our time looking at contentment and godliness. And we said godliness is the attitude or character that seeks to please God. The attitude or character that seeks to do the pleasure of God, the will of God. At each and every time you want to find out what is the plan of God for my life? What is the purpose of God? What is the pleasure of God? What does God want me to do now? That's the mental attitude you have. You are always seeking to please God. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter number 5, verse 9.
Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well pleasing to Him.
Amen. Amen. Let's make it our goal, our purpose in life, our aim. If someone asks you, what is your aim in life? You say, I want to be well pleasing to God. I want to praise God to the highest level humanly possible. I want to worship Him with all that I am and all that I have. Every ability in me, every strength in me, I want you to worship God. So what is your purpose in life? To praise God. With my life, with all that God has given me, with my strength, with my talents, with my abilities, with my gifts, I want to praise God. I want to be well pleasing unto Him. Make it your goal. Make it your aim. You know, when you are shooting, you have an aim. You must shoot at a particular place. When the footballers are playing, they're chasing that small thing in the field. They have two goals. They want to pass it through those two goals. That's their aim. Even if you see them going around like this, they're just cheating you. They're looking for that goal. So what is your aim in life? To be well pleasing to God. Amen? That's our aim. Amen?
Amen.
When you wake up every morning, you say, God, in everything that I do, everything that I think, everything I say, let me be well pleasing to you. Because that is godliness. Living a life that honors God. Living a life that shows the character of Christ. Manifesting the character of Christ through your Christian walk. That is godliness. And that's why the Bible says godliness with contentment is great gain. So we looked at contentment again, and we said contentment is resting in Christ Jesus. Contentment is being sufficient with what you already have, yet pursuing more grounds in a godly manner. You are contented. You are godly and you are contented. You are satisfied with what you have today. You are not looking over your shoulders and saying, I wish this was mine. I don't know why I have not got that. No, you are working hard. Yes, you are working hard. But you are working hard knowing that all this is the glory of God. You are like David saying that the Lord is my shepherd. What I need today, He has already supplied. And because He has supplied what I need today, I am confident that I have everything I need today. Contentment is refusing to allow your needs to define who you are. We said that last Sunday. Don't allow yourself to be called that man with cancer. No. Or that poor woman. No. Don't allow yourself to be called names that this world has put on you. You have a name, and the name of God. Praise God. So refuse. Contentment is rejecting everything that defines you out of what God says you are. If God says you are my righteousness, that's your name. If God says you are a saint, that's your name. If God says you are my family, that's your name. If God says that you are the royal priest, that's your name. Whatever God calls you, that is your name. Don't start calling yourself poor man. Don't allow lack of money to define you. And don't allow more money to define you. Don't call yourself a rich man. I think that's what Paul says in Philippians chapter 4. Let's just brush through again. We are just revising what we did so that we can go in there. In Philippians chapter 4, let's read quickly from verse 10. Paul says, but I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at least your care for me has flourished again though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. Paul is talking to the church of the Philippians, telling them that now you have got another opportunity to care for me. Your care for me has flourished again. Flourished. It's now evident before people. Everybody knows that the church of Macedonia is caring for the apostle. And he's saying, because of this, I rejoice. Now follow him. Follow him. In verse 11 it says, not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. Verse 12, I know how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere, in all things, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. Paul says, when I have and when I don't have, when I'm hungry and when I'm full, when I have and when I'm in need, all these things, they don't define me. I remain Apostle Paul, the servant of the Most High God. Don't allow things to define you. Paul is writing this letter right from the prison, and it's not saying, Paul, we're suffering in prison. No! Prison is not the problem. He knows his aim. Whether in prison or out of prison, whether hungry or a fool, whether he has things or he doesn't have things, he knows his aim is to glorify God. Praise God.
Amen.
Does Apostle Paul have a friend in this place?
Yes.
You can say, my aim is to glorify God.
Yes.
Come on, join me and say, my aim is to glorify God.
Yes.
Regardless of what I have or what I don't have. I hope you mean it. There are things when you say you are tested. So you don't mean you just shut up. Look at verse 13. He says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What things can he do? The things he has mentioned over there. He's saying he can be content whether when he has or when he doesn't have. When he abounds and when he is in need. When he's hungry and when he's full. He says, all these things, I achieve them through Christ Jesus, who strengthens you. Not by his own strength. He knows that he must get the power supply from the Holy Spirit for him to achieve that status. For him to achieve a status of contentment, relaxing, resting in Christ Jesus, regardless of what is against you, regardless of the situation you are going through, regardless of your wants and your house. Resting, being at rest. You always have that smile. You always have that stride in your legs. You always stand tall, regardless of what is going through your life. A long time ago, you will see people mostly happy during the end of the month. Long time ago. Because people, you know, they have money. Even the way they walk in town, they just walk slowly, nicely, they can pay their steps. Because they have money. But when the month was going at the corner, you will see people rushing to matatus. They want to go home. They don't want to stay in town. Those days are not saying today. Those days. Today, even the money we earn is not enough for our needs. So at the end of the month is the saddest moment for you. Because you think about landlord, you think about school fees, you think about that and that, you think about this. And you just can't budget your money and you just become sad. But let me tell you, your money is more than what you need. Praise God. If you start being satisfied in Christ Jesus, being contented in Christ Jesus, you start discovering that there's so much wastage of your money that Christ can help you stop. If your focus, the center of your focus, is Christ Jesus and not your needs. If you make your needs the center of your focus, you will never ever have enough money. But if you make Jesus Christ the center of your focus, some of those things that are disturbing you, he'll take them away. You will have more money to last you the whole month. You will never complain that the month is in the corner. You will never cry that January has 9 days, because God will be taking away your case. So Paul says, I can do all things. Can do all things. Everything, as long as you are centered on Christ Jesus, is possible. Praise God.
Amen.
Verse 14, the Bible says, nevertheless, you have done well that you have shared in my distress. Now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church shared with me concerning giving and receiving, but you only. For even in Thessalonica, you sent aid once and again for my necessities. So Apostle says, I also go through needs. If you think you have needs in this place, go through the Bible. You will see servants of God who have gone through needs. More serious needs than what you are going through. Apostle Paul says, I have necessities. There are things I need in my life. I need clothing, I need food. I'm in prison. But it tells Macedonian church that you are the only churches. Imagine after he has planted all these churches, only the church at Philippi could minister to these needs. And he says, that is not a problem to me. He's not cursing those churches that are not ministering to him. He's not complaining, you see, Corinthians, they are so rich and they planted that church. Now they're just enjoying themselves there and they're not taking care of me. No. No, that's not a servant of God. That's not Apostle Paul. But he also commends the church of Macedonia for taking care of him in the time of need. But look at what he tells them in the next verse. In verse 17. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. Verse 18. Indeed, I have all and abound. I am full, having received from Epaphroditus the things sent from you, a sweet-smelling aroma, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing, well-pleasing to God. You see that word again? Well-pleasing to God. So one way that we can be well-pleasing to God is to minister to the needs of each other. To minister to one another's needs. When a brother is in need, you minister to their needs. You will be well-pleasing to God. And minister to the servants of God. Minister to the servant of God, you will be well-pleasing to God. And Paul says, when you minister to him as an apostle, it's not that you have done him any favor, because whether you give him or don't give him, he's still at well. He's not looking for things from the church of Macedonia. He says, no, that's not my aim. I don't want things from you, but when you give me, I know one thing, you have pleased God. And when you please God, your account in heaven is increased. Praise God. That's what giving does. Giving does not make the recipient better, it makes the giver better. Do you hear that? I'm saying this. If you came to me and gave me money, you have done nothing in my life. Don't go away bragging that I helped, Pastor. You have not helped me. If you think you are helping me, you stay with your money. But giving me money does not help me. It helps you spiritually. It is well pleasing to God. It increases your account in heaven. You don't give me that I may feel good, but you give for your own pleasure. Praise God. That's what Paul is saying here. Everyone who gives money, Bible says, not that I seek the gift, but I seek the fruit that abounds to your account. It is the giver who increases, the giver who is more blessed, is the giver who receives abundantly from God. I know what the Bible says. You know what the Bible says? In Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 7. Do I have a giver in this place?
Yeah.
You are a giver, shout amen. Do you have a giver?
Yeah.
Say shout amen. You are a giver?
Yeah.
Now I want you to hear Hebrews 7, 7.
Hebrews 7, 7. Now beyond all contradiction, the lesser is blessed by the better.
Did you hear that?
Yeah.
For those who are talking about Melchizedek and Abraham, and in that context, because Melchizedek was greater than Abraham and he blessed him, but the giver is always greater than the recipient. Can you receive when your hand is up? Praise God. Let's continue with the Philippians chapter 4. Now in verse 18 he says, it's well pleasing unto God, and verse 19 says, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now, I want you to look at that statement clearly again. God supplies all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. So God does not supply some of your needs. If you are a giver here, Paul is not addressing givers. God will do what? Supply. How many needs? Why don't you take it personal? First of all, say, I am a giver.
And God
shall supply. How many needs?
All.
How many needs?
All.
Do you believe it?
Yes.
How many needs?
All.
Amen. God shall supply all your needs. God's supply is proportional to your purpose and your need. God's supply is proportional to your purpose in life and your needs. If you went to a tap to take water to drink, and the tap releases a drum of water, will that be good? What's your need at that time? A glass of water to drink. So God's supply in your life is directly equivalent to your need and purpose in life. There are things God will never give you because it's not in line with your purpose in life. Or if it's in line with your purpose, you have refused to live according to your purpose on earth. And there will be no need for you to receive them. There are things you will cry for. There are things you will cash and pray. There are things you people will lie their hands on your head until all your air is gone away. God will never release them in your life. Because either you have refused to walk in your purpose, you are not ready to walk in your purpose, or you don't need them in life. God only supplies your need. The quicker you start walking in your purpose on earth here, the better. Because then you receive an abundant supply from God. I think I'm in trouble today. So God will supply all the needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Now it is always by Christ Jesus. So if it is by Christ Jesus, the first place you must begin, you must make sure that before you ask from God, you are born again. Because it's by Christ Jesus. He supplies to those who have put their faith in Christ Jesus. That's what the Bible says in Romans 8 verse 32. Yeah. That's what it says. It's only through Christ Jesus that God supplies your needs.
Romans 8, 32. He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us?
How shall he not? How shall he not? No, no. There's a small thing there. How shall he?
How shall he not with him?
Not with
him.
It must be with who?
Him.
With Christ Jesus. Amen. God did not spare Christ Jesus when you are still a sinner. He sent him to die for your sins and pay the penalty of your sins, that when you believe in him, he saves you by grace through faith. And God says, if I saved you by grace, you didn't have to work for your salvation. You didn't have to pay for your salvation. You didn't even have to pray for your salvation. You didn't have to give anything for your salvation. All that you needed to do is to trust in the finished work of Christ at the cross, and you are saved. God says, I saved you when you are desperate, hopeless, and helpless. When you are lost, when you are a sinner, when you are headed to hell. I gave you Christ Jesus, free of any costs. I didn't ask you for anything, free of any costs. I didn't require anything from you. I saved you. Now, how will I not freely give you all things, but together with Christ Jesus? Praise God. In other words, there's nothing you can receive from God apart from through Christ Jesus. There's nothing whatsoever you can receive from God apart from through Christ Jesus. So let's go back to Timothy again. So in verse 7, the Bible says, for we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with this we shall be content. Now, it's a principle of life, and if you understand this principle, you live a very peaceful life. And the wisdom of God is that our entry point in the world and our exit point, we come with nothing, we go with nothing. The whole world and its fullness is God who created it. And when he created it, you are not born. Everything you think you own, you found it here as God's creation. You came in the world with nothing, and you will live with nothing. Now the time you live in this world is the shortest period of your life, because your eternity is with God. The longest period of your life is in eternity with God. So most of us have focus on this world. Our main focus is on this world. How much do we have? How much can I get? How many houses? How many cars? How many floors? How many zandas? There are places if you are digging your land and then you are able to cross your brother's land, that becomes a case. Chief must come. Because just 1 inch into your brother's land is a very dangerous thing to do. So the chief must be called to come and solve between a brother and a brother. Maybe both of you are born again because of the same church. But when it comes to 1 tenth of land in my land, chief has to come. This land, you didn't come with it, and this land, you will leave it there. You brought nothing in this world, and you can take nothing out of it. Look at Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and verse 15.
And he came from his mother's womb, naked shall he return to go as he came. And he shall take nothing from his labor, which he may carry away in his hand.
Imagine the futility of this world. You work very hard. You want a rich bank account. You want many houses. You want many cars. You want this and that. You want vast lands. People have thousands of acres of lands. But the moment God calls you home, you just want a 4x6 bed. That's the only piece of land you want. And if you don't have your 4x6, the government can give you like that. Take this serious. You are struggling to have everything in this world. And some of us are even having depression because we don't have. We are going through shameful moments. We walk with our heads down. And what do we have in this world? We don't even have a piece of land. You came with nothing. And you will live with nothing. When your time to depart comes, you cannot say, pack me with my car. I told you a story here last time, whereby a man who was very rich called his wife and says, I want to make a covenant with you. And the wife says, yes, daddy. When I die, because he had been diagnosed with cancer and he was dying, when I die, I want you to bury me with all my money. And the wife says, I will do that. Then the man died, and the wife wrote him a check of all his money. He told him, go and cash where you are going. That's all your money. I've gone through your banks. This is how much you have in this world. Go and cash it where you are going. She put the check in the coffin. Yes, Ecclesiastes 9:10. Read it, please.
Whatever you do, do well. Mm-hmm. For when you go to the grave, there will be no work or planning or knowledge or wisdom.
So where you are going there, there will be nothing there. I know in African tradition it's very bad to talk about where we are going, about death. But whether you talk about it or not, it's part of us. Now, I want to have this mentality when you wake up in the morning, that God will supply all my needs.
Yes. Amen.
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 There's no need that I have to fulfill the purpose of God that He will not supply. If it's to feed my children, God will supply. It's something that needs to be part of your life. Don't wake up like in the morning worrying, where will I get food today? The Bible says if you have food, clothing, and shelter, you should be okay. So God, even God in heaven knows that food, clothing, and shelter are your basic needs. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
These are some things you wake up in the morning and thank God for them. Instead of complaining, where will I get rent this month? Tell God, thank you, because you always ensure that every month I have rent to pay. I may not know where I get the money today, but you know. And walk out of your house. Don't sit like that and sleep. Most of you have read the story of this man who went to look for a job, and he had some, and he covered about 2,000 shillings in his pocket. And when he was going to look for a job, they interviewed him, and they asked him for his email address. And the man said, I don't have an email address. I remember when we were with the pious in, was it Kano? We were preaching the gospel there, then we told the people there who were there, fill in this place your email addresses. They ask email on Wiki. They don't know what email is in Kano. Just Kano here. So this man was asked for his email address. He says, no, I don't have an email address. And he was told, sorry, our company cannot employ someone without an email address. And he didn't get a job. So he walked away, so frustrated, and he saw some tomatoes in the market. So he bought tomatoes for 2,000 shillings, went home, packed them, and started selling door to door. By the end of the day, he had gone back to the market 3 times. The next day, he was pulling a cart because he could now afford tomatoes for the cart. The next day, he was putting them on a pickup. The next day, he had a grocery store, big grocery store. Then an insurance company came to insure his grocery store. They asked him, where is your email address? He said, I don't have. They asked him, how do you do business without an email address? He just looked at that man. He told him, if I had an email address, I would not be doing this business. He'll be washing some floor somewhere as a messenger. But because he didn't have an email address, now he's the owner of a grocery store. You just need God to direct you in what you need to do. You can have that 2,000 shillings, and within 1 year, you are a millionaire. Amen.
Amen.
Does somebody believe God in this place?
Yes.
You can begin anywhere, but saying that what I am doing must be well pleasing to God. I am doing my business to the glory of God. I am doing my business to make sure that the kingdom of God expands on this earth. I want to see missionaries going out. I want to see good equipment in the church. I want to see the land bought. That's the drive. I want to see my family happy. Because family is part of your ministry. Praise God. Actually, if you are a man here, the first ministry you have is not church. The first ministry you have is family. You cannot serve God until you have served your family. Amen?
Amen.
I'm talking to men, not women. Amen?
Amen?
That's the greatest ministry you have. So when you are doing your, when you are beginning your business, when you are knocking doors looking for a job, when you are doing all this, you are saying, this is for the pleasure of God. That's the motivating factor when you're going out. When you are approaching your boss for that promotion, you are saying, if I get this promotion, I'll be in a better place. I'll give a better offering. I'll take care of my family well. I'll do this and this. All the things that God has placed under your care, you are saying, God, if I get this money now, it will be unto your pleasure. Praise God.
Amen.
That should be our mentality. Our mentality must be to the pleasure of God. And the Bible says here, we brought nothing in this world, we labor, we accumulate, but again, we leave them. We labor, we accumulate, we compare ourselves with other people, we tell them we are better than you. Look at the car I'm driving, I'm better than you, I'm living in a better place, I'm better than you, look at my suit, I'm better than you. But when you die, if you take this suit in the mortuary when I'm dead, and look at what the mortuary attendants will do to it, you'll cry. You know what they do to it? They tear the whole bag and throw it away. So that when I'm lying in the coffin, you only see a suit here. But then I've worked in a hospital. I've worked in a merchant because I worked in a hospital and I go everywhere. And I know what merchants do. You take people waste their money, they buy the most expensive shoe suits. You are told you go home. Because how do you dress a dead body? So it is torn. There's some things. Sometimes when they just put this place, the rest of the material they throw it away. You leave it in this world. Eric said he went to the mortuary one day and he found some people crying and the mortuary attendant pushed the body. They said, stop. That is Professor Bana. How do you care? Whether you're a professor, you're a new professor, you will take nothing out of this world. Don't fight each other because of the things of this world. Don't connive because of the things of this world. Don't steal because of the things of this world. Don't lie because of the things of this world. You will get them, but when the time to depart comes, you will let them go. Job chapter 1, verse 20, 22.
Big Job arose, took his robe, and shaved his head. And he fell to the ground and worshipped. And he said,
hold on there. And he fell to the ground and did what?
Worshipped.
Worshipped. Let me just read the. Let's see why he's worshipping. Just a minute before you tell us that. Let's see why he's worshipping. Just go to verse. From chapter 18.
While he was still speaking, another also came and said, your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And suddenly, a great wind came from across the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house. and it fell on the young people, and they are dead. And I alone have escaped to tell you. And Job arose, took his robe, and shaved his head, and he fell to the ground and worshipped.
What should cause a man to do that? This is a man who will understand that there's nothing in this world, his wife, his children, his money, his property, that is better than his relationship with God. This is a man who has put God at the highest place in his life. He knows that he needs this thing in this life, but he knows God holds his eternity. And he can hear that you have lost everything, you have lost all your children, and he can kneel down and still worship the same God and not curse him. What kind of piety is this? Job understands that there is nothing in this world that can be compared to God. And then he makes the following statements, that naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return there. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrong. Most preachers will hear them refuse this verse, that the Lord gave and the Lord God has taken. But I want you to hear this. There is nothing, there is no power that the devil has over your life unless God allows it to happen. God is all powerful. God is sovereign. His rule is a king. Even right now, with the breath of his nostril, he can destroy the devil. You will never hear the name of Satan again. If he chooses to do that today, nothing can come your way unless you have allowed it or God has allowed it. And we allow it when we stray away from what God has called us to do. As we have said always in this church, if you have a nice car and you park it somewhere carelessly and someone breaks inside and steals, you can also blame God for someone breaking in your car. You park it in the wrong place. You need to look for a secure place to park your car. If you walk with money stuffed in your pockets and young men see that money, people who have not taken tea in their houses and they pounce on you and take your money, you cannot say, how can this happen to the servant of God? You want it to happen. So there is a part you do to take care of what God has given you and to walk in righteousness, but God is above all. God is above you. God is above the devil. God is all powerful and he can stop everything from happening in the world. But sometimes, because God knows what he's doing with your life, he can stand aside and see. Do you just trust me because of the things I've given you, or you can trust me even without those things? Job knew the secret. Job said, I didn't bring any of these things in this world, and when I die, I will not take any of them where I'm going. So blessed be the name of God. Praise God. I told you this is the most difficult place for me to preach, but I just preached. So Psalm 49, verse 6 to 9.
Those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother or give to God a ransom for him. For the redemption of their souls is costly, and it shall cease forever, that he should continue to live eternally and not see the beat.
Go to verse 16 to 20.
Do not be afraid when one becomes rich, when the glory of his house is increased. For when he dies, he shall carry nothing away. His glory shall not descend after him. Though while he lives, he blesses himself. For men will praise you when you do well for yourself. He shall go to the generation of his fathers. They shall never see light. A man who is in honor yet does not understand is like the beast that perish.
Amen. So in verse 6, the Bible says, those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitudes of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his own brother, nor give to God a ransom for him. You can't save somebody with your riches. Riches don't save. Only the blood of Christ Jesus, the ransom that God takes for the life of your brothers. So there's no way you can have riches until you save somebody. Redemption is of the Lord. Redemption of the Lord. If you go to verse 16, he said, do not be afraid when one becomes rich, when the glory of his house is increased. For when he dies, he shall carry nothing away. His glory shall not descend after him. Don't be afraid. When you see people stealing money, people corrupt around you, people doing all kinds of things to amass wealth, don't think that you are a lesser person. We are not being intimidated by people who are getting wealth by wrong means. And you start thinking that, God, what about me? What about me? You are struggling, you barely get your food every day, you struggle to get your clothing, you struggle to get your school fees to your children, and you feel that you have a lesser God than this man. Go home and read Psalm 73. It will tell you where their destiny is. Go home and read Psalm 73. It will tell you where their destiny is. So we have this principle that we must adopt now. That the believer should never be preoccupied or obsessed with the desire to accumulate material wealth. The preoccupation of a believer, that which obsesses a believer, that which dominates your mind, should never be that desire, that obsession to have much and much more material wealth. That should not dominate you. Let the word of God dominate your soul. Let the focus of Christ dominate your soul. Then God knows your needs and will supply all your needs. Praise God.
Yeah.
Are we still together in this place?
Yeah.
But I lost you a long time ago.
Yeah.
A believer should not be preoccupied. Your day-to-day thoughts should not be how much do I get more money. No. How much do I please God? If you seek to please God in all that you do, these things that you are looking for shall come your way. Haven't you read in the book of Matthew, chapter 6 and verse 33, says what? Seek ye first what? And all this righteousness, and these things that you are fighting about, you are laboring about, they shall be added unto you. If you go to a verse before that, it says all these things, the pagans, the nations outside there, they fight for them. But you, the children of God, should not fight for these things because they will be added to you.
Amen.
It's God who will add them to you. Not by your cleverness, not by your fighting other people, not by pushing and shoving, no. So our preoccupation is that when you wake up in the morning, you are thinking about God. You want to worship Him. You want to praise Him. You want to please Him with your life. And in the process, you are doing what God brought you in this world to do. Both your spiritual things and your labor. The labor of your hands. And in the process, God will know how to lift you up. A believer's preoccupation is not, I want more money. I want to be the richest man. I want to make more money. I want to make more money. Your money should never occupy your mind. Don't be obsessed with money. Because the Bible says, the one who loves money never gets enough. If you love money and you're obsessed with money, there is no single day in your life you will say, I have enough. You never feel satisfaction inside you. You will always feel, I want more. Do you know when you don't have money, you go to the kiosk here and you eat manondo and you are good. Or they give you chapati and they push soup on it. Chafu, eh? And you are good. But when you start getting a few shillings, you feel, no, I don't fit in this kiosk here. You don't need to go to a restaurant. Eh? Now you go to a restaurant and you get more money, you feel, no, I need to eat from a hotel. So you go to at least a hotel. Then you get more money, you feel, no, I need to go to a 5-star hotel. You get more money, you feel, I need to fly to Mombasa for my lunch and come back to Nairobi. There are people who do like that. There are people who call each other and say, can you meet in Naivasha for lunch? And they fly from all over the country, they go to Naivasha for lunch, and they go back to where they came from. You think I'm lying? It's very true. People have things that walk in the air. When you are saying from here to Naivasha, how many hours it is, and James will tell you, it's about 1.5 hours. Then that man looks at you, 1.5 hours? It's supposed to be 10 minutes. Because the thing we do like this is in Naivasha. Right now, if you go to a man for our position, what are they fighting for? Own a car? No, they are now past a car. Every politician wants to own a jet. To own a nice car is no longer prestigious in Kenya. People have jets. So the private jets. I heard another man say, that the grandchildren go to a private school, and when he was asked, what school is this? He says, I don't know, because it's private to them. So they own private jets. But the Bible says here, however much that you increase in wealth, you will never take it to the next world. Amen. So let's agree that God's will is that you become rich towards Him. God wants people who you are getting riches, but this riches you are saying is the praise and glory of God on this earth. Rich towards God is when you are amassing this wealth, is because you want to see new churches being planted. You want to see gospel being preached. You want to see missionaries going out. You want to see the church increasing. You want to see the people who are in need being elevated their needs. That is your work. That's your purpose. Not that you may be called the richest man around. Now if you go back to Timothy, where we were reading, 1 Timothy chapter 6, look at, I'm just passing through quickly these verses. Look at it again, in verse 8 to 10, the Bible says, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men into destruction. So, those who are preoccupied with the obsession of getting rich, these things happen to them. Number one, they fall into various temptations. Various temptations. I saw a very sad thing on social media the other day, that there are sisters who have two young daughters, I think they are below 5 years, and they sell them to men at a very expensive price. They sell them to men and then they make money. So they use children for sex trafficking. And these are two sisters who got expectant. They gave birth to their own children and they are using their own children for their financial. They are obsessed with being rich. So they are selling their own children. If someone reaches that level, even if you are a millionaire, so what? There are so many well-meaning women right now who are in immorality because of money. They are obsessed with getting rich. Even for 10 shillings, she would mess her life. Now it's not just for women, even men. I hear men marry men. God's will is that a man marries a woman, but now the world says a man can marry a man, and it's okay. And this obsession is because of money. If you look, people are lying every day in this world, going through different kind of temptations, just because of money. You can feel in what you do. Just go out of your way. Do something and God leads something evil, something unrighteous, just because of money. Feel in yourself, right? But the Bible says, those who are obsessed with getting rich, they fall into various temptations. If you go in the government, there's a lot of corruption. Because people are obsessed with getting rich. We are crying here today because of drugs. Someone knows very well somebody's child will take these drugs, their mind will be corrupted. But because he wants money, he doesn't care. He's a teacher in school, he uses his position to sell drugs to children. Now teachers are coming with sweets, less with drugs, they give to your children. Then they give them free for 3 days. Your children now are addicted to it, now they tell them, buy your sweets now. As a parent, you need to train your children, don't just take anything from anyone outside there. No one loves our children today. But why are they doing like this? They know this thing is evil. If you look at people who are now in drugs, you look at them, you just tremble. People have become garbage because of alcoholism, because of drug abuse, because of all this. And there's a man somewhere becoming rich because of this. And some of them attend church services, they give good offerings, they say hallelujah, amen, and they do these things outside there. If you are obsessed with getting rich, you fall into various temptations. Christians now are stealing. Who can tell what you do outside there? Only God knows it. But Christians are stealing outside there. Some of them even violently, and they come to church and sit down and keep quiet. Some of them with a pen, they come to sit down at church and sit down. There's no difference whether you stole with a pen or with a gun, you're still a thief. The whole world is obsessed with the material wealth getting better and better. You think that by having money, money will make you a better person. Money is just exposing who you are, evil. People are telling lies, conning others. If you go to jail, you'll find many people in jail right now because they have stolen, they have conned people, they are fraudsters, they are exploiting people outside there, they are thieves. And yet, they came from congregations like this one. That obsession with money, you must take it to the cross today. And tell God, I know there's a plan and a purpose you have for me. You never intended me to be poor, but I want to get my money in the right way. Praise God. Do I still have a friend here? You want to be rich, but through godly means. You can work hard and become rich. You don't have to steal. You don't have to con people. You don't have to lie. You don't have to be involved in sexual immorality. You don't have to do all these things to be rich. You don't have to sell drugs or buy drugs. You don't have to do all those things. We are hearing bad testimonies about our very own sisters, our very own brothers, because they are looking for money. Stop being obsessed with money. Allow yourself to be obsessed with God. Amen.
Amen.
What did the sin say in Matthew chapter 6, verse 24? In the Venice Bible, as Matthew.
No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon.
Let the deepest affection of your life be God. Let your love be unto God. Let your obsession be to God. Let your devotion be to God. Not to money. Not to money. Imagine you can trust God that God will bless the work of my hand. He will prosper me through the right means. Amen?
Amen.
You want to trust God?
Yes.
That He will bless the work of your hands?
Yes.
He will prosper you?
Yes.
Through the right means?
Yes.
Don't. And if you are hearing my voice, don't employ wrong means of getting money. Don't hurt others. Don't break relationships. Some of us are even hurting our own families. There are men who are stealing from their wives and their wives are stealing from their husbands. You can't leave 200 shillings in your court. When it's taken there, it is inspected. How can you steal from your husband? You are stealing from yourself. Because the two have become one. Is somebody hearing me in this place?
Yes.
Either we reign in righteousness or we don't. You go in the jacket, you say, but where did I spend these 2,000 shillings? I had 10,000 shillings here. And this money was for business. Now, where did I spend this 2,000? And your wife is looking at her as if she doesn't have an idea what you are talking about. She's an inspector. The moment you arrive in the house, pop, she knows everything. The many calls you have made, the money in your pocket, everything. When you go to the bathroom, she has finished her accounting. It's not a good thing. And it's not only women who do that, even men. There are men who ransack their wives' handbags. These bad manners a Christian should never have. Amen?
Amen?
We can raise a family in this place that honors God. Amen?
Yeah.
Steve was teaching here last time, and he said the worst thing to do these days is to give a fellow brother in church a loan. Because if you tell your brother, just keep praying for me, we are trusting God. He can never pay. Believers have become the most untrusted big people on earth. Sometimes you are looking for a house, you say, I'm born again, and you are told no, they are all taken out. Because the landlord knows, you will tell him the born again stories and you will not pay your rent. I'm telling you the truth. We can raise again the bar of Christianity. Praise God.
Amen.
We can have integrity. Do you have somebody here today?
Yes.
We can have integrity again back in the church.
Yes.
We are not stealing from one another. We are not cheating one another. We are not lying. We are not immorally looking for money outside there. We are serving God in righteousness. And God is able to make us rich.
Amen.
Haven't you heard of Abraham? What did he steal from anybody? Have you heard of David? Did he steal from anybody? Have you read about Solomon when he was the king of Israel? The Bible says that even gold was common on the streets of Israel. Did he steal from anybody? Solomon was even a giver. He worshipped God in a way that no other man has ever worshipped. He gave sacrifices that no other person has ever given. And yet he was the richest king in Israel. Until Queen Sheba has to go and see who is this Solomon. And Jesus said, a greater than Solomon is here.
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Did Jesus say so?
Yeah.
A greater than Solomon is here.
Yeah.
And now where does he live right now?
India.
Where is Jesus right now?
India.
So who are you? Greater than who?
Solomon.
You don't believe it. I'm telling you, you can become rich more than Solomon if you use godly principles of living. If you walk in the purpose of God. Because I said God supplies according to the need and how you fulfill your purpose on earth here. The divine purpose you fulfill will attract God's supply. So we fall in different kinds of temptations. Look at that verse again, verse 8. Sorry, I'm just finishing. Verse 9. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptations. Temptations, number 2. Snares. They are trapped. Imagine. I don't know if you have ever been a hunter. Sometimes you make a snare in the bush. You are looking. I used to hunt for squirrels when I was young. You make a snare in the bush, and you know a squirrel will pass here. When a squirrel passes here, the snare snaps, and the squirrel hangs there. Satan has put snares for us outside there. And he wants you as a believer to enter that snare. Then he lifts you up and says, hey, he was a believer. Look at the way he looks like now. Look at what he has done. And then people start talking, oh, this is how pastors are. Oh, this is how church people are these days. Because Satan wants to lift you up before people. Dirty. He's making traps for you. And he knows the easiest way to get you is through money. The love of money. The love of money means that you worship money. So there are snares. God will give you the rest. And then there are very foolish and harmful lusts that hurt others. Many foolish and harmful lusts. They hurt your family. They hurt your Christian life. They hurt your testimony. They hurt your business. They had your office. One day I had a very good friend of mine, very close friend of mine, and I was told he's in the police cells. So I go to the police, and the police are laughing. They're telling me, this man is your friend. He's very foolish. I said, what has he done? A man who works in a bank, he earns more than 50,000 shillings, and that time he stole 10,000 bomb, and he was in jail. That's a snare. Because you can't trust God for your supply, you think you must steal. And that hurt his family, it hurt his Christian life, it hurt his job, he was sacked, he spent time in prison and he was sacked because of stealing money. He's ashamed, he can't even come back to Nairobi, he stays in the village. Because everybody, former workers, they look at him and they laugh at him. This man stole 10,000 shillings. Imagine just sitting down to plan how you will steal 10,000. 10,000, you can even ask for God, you just give you food. You can ask a friend, you don't have to steal. That's why we are a family. You can go to a brother, to a sister, and tell a sister, I have this genuine problem, and God will just give you. A brother will just give you. Because you have a genuine problem, you have prayed, and the Lord has put in your heart who to go. Don't ask everybody else. You pray about and God directs you. Go and see your sister so-and-so. She'll help you. The Bible says that this harmful lust would drown men in destruction. They drown men in destruction. To drown. Imagine being drowned in destruction. You are deep inside destruction. Just like someone drowns in the water. You are drowned in destruction. Brethren, this is very important for this church. This church has a potential, men and women here who can grow rich financially if only you allow God to work through you, both to will and to do according to His pleasure. And I'm serious. I look around and I see millionaires. But because, number one, either we are lazy and we don't understand the purpose of God in our lives, or number two, we don't know the right means of looking for money, we are like an old lion that cannot go to hunt until even the dogs come and attack it. It's a lion, it has grown old, it cannot go to hunt, it sleeps down until hyenas come to attack it. We can rise up as a church. Do you believe it?
Yes.
Can we rise up?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. I'm finishing. I'm not taking more of the time. So the Bible says they go to destruction and perdition. Perdition. A terrible waste of themselves. A terrible waste of their time. A terrible waste of their efforts. Perdition. You go to destruction and you are lost. Everything you worked for is a waste. I've seen people who have got money in evil ways, then they spend all their time bribing policemen, running away, hiding. What good is all this? One prayer that we are praying today here is that money will never be our God. Amen. Do I have a friend?
Yes.
Money will never be
our God.
We don't want to be obsessed with money. Whether we have money or not, we must still worship God. Amen. And a prayer we are praying today that we are trusting God from right now onwards, He'll give us wisdom to become rich in the right way.
Amen.
Anybody wants to pray that? Shout amen.
Amen.
We want to become rich. We want to have finances. We want to have material things that honors God, but using the right means, in the right way, in righteousness, standing on the foundation of righteousness. Are you tired? Cutting corners? Looking always on your shoulder, see who is following you, who is seeing what you are doing. Are you tired? I know it may not be all of us, but one of us here is hearing what I'm saying. This one person is hearing what I'm saying. Can't you walk in freedom, in spiritual freedom? Can you stand where in freedom? Our deepest affection must never be turned towards money, but towards God. Amen. We can find spiritual fulfillment just if we have a Christ-centered life. We can find spiritual fulfillment. When we learn that there is now no condemnation for them that are in Christ Jesus, that is true. God will never condemn you. God will never judge you. God will never sentence you in any future because He has already saved you and paid for all your sins. But you are living in shame and guilt of the things that you are doing. If you think that what you are doing to get money is good, come and testify here right now. Come and give us a testimony. They bring shame in your life. They curtail your spiritual progress. And when your spiritual progress is curtailed, everything about you is destroyed. The Bible says, you are drowned in destruction and perdition. Everything you work on is a waste, is vanity. You chase after the wind. We want to lay a new foundation. The Bible says the love of money is the root cause of all evils. Tell me one sin in the world that is not sponsored by money. Every sin either has an aim of getting money or money is behind it. If you love money, you must fall into shameful temptations. If you love God, God will lead you where all the gold and silver is. Amen?
Amen.
So what do we choose today?
Love
God. Love God.
Yes.
So let's say, like Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians 12 verse 9, that the grace of God is sufficient. Amen? Do you believe the grace of God is sufficient?
Yes.
Even in our financial situations,
yes.
Grace is sufficient.
Yes.
And what is grace? Grace is favor from God. Amen?
Amen.
Grace is all that God is ready to do for you, purely based on the work of Christ on the cross. Grace is the kindness of God to those who are undeserving. You may not deserve to be a millionaire right now, but if you understand that the grace of God is sufficient, the Bible says you can become a millionaire today.
Yeah.
Praise be to God.
Amen.
But you must put your hand on something. You must touch something. I say, God, I'm starting to sell tomatoes. I have 200 shillings. I'll go and buy tomatoes and pack them of 10 bob, 10 bob, 10 bob. Walk around the houses, sell them. I know I can raise 10,000. I can make it become 100,000. It can become a million. I can grow from tomatoes. Touch something in your life. But in our walk, we are contented. We are telling God, your grace is sufficient. Praise be to God. Whatever you do, your grace is sufficient. Again today we'll pray the way we prayed last Sunday, that God may give us wisdom to come out of poverty and make riches through the right way. Because it is Him who gives us the power to make wealth. Praise God. Do I have a friend here?
Yeah.
Let's rise up on our feet.
Oh Lord my God, when I know some wonder, consider all the works thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout, thy